Recently, there's been a huge hubbub, and I'm sure you're aware, regarding the purported crisis in physics. I had an interview with Sean Carroll, and he defended academia. His defense, though, wasn't just out of allegiance to academia. To me, it seemed a counterpoise to the growing societal mistrust in science, and he sees that as a detrimental trend. Today, I would like us to focus on not only the stagnation in fundamental physics, which is a specific claim, but perhaps the crisis in physics in general, maybe even science as a whole. And I'd like to hear what you have to say. I'll bring up objections as they occur to me, perhaps other people's objections as well. And I want to hear your objections to those objections. And we can even get into the issues of causes and solutions. Okay, well, why don't you distinguish the crisis in fundamental physics versus the crisis in physics? And then we can get to science afterward. And also, what is meant by crisis? Because I made a claim of stagnation to Sean Carroll, which is different than crises.
Right. So it's actually, when I give talks about this, this is always the first thing that I say. Like, I don't like talking about crisis. I talk about stagnation because it's clearer what it means. You know, a lot of people actually think, like, if we had a real crisis, that would be a good thing, because a crisis is an opportunity for a breakthrough or something, so we would know what to hit on. But that's not what it is. So to me, I think calling it a stagnation is much more accurate, because that's what I see. We're just not going anywhere. We're just, you know, like on a treadmill, pretending we're running, but not making progress. So I actually can't remember I've ever talked about, you know, the crisis in physics overall, because I don't really know a lot about exactly what's going on in physics overall. It's just such a huge field with so many subdisciplines. So I tend to focus on what I call the foundations of physics, where we think about the most fundamental questions.
Right.
Because that's what I know about, right? And so the issue there is that we haven't really made any progress on answering the big open questions ever since they occurred, you know, like a century ago. And then we made progress until the Standard Model was completed sometime in the 1970s, depending on how you count. And then you could say, you know, for the next 5, 10, 15 years or something, people were just trying out different things, and they expected it to go somewhere. And at some point, you know, sometime in the mid 1980s, maybe 1990s, it just went wrong, because what happened was that they started doing the same thing over and over again, and it just didn't work, and they never revised those methods. So we still don't know what dark matter is made of, if it's made of anything. We still haven't figured out how to quantize gravity. We still don't really understand how quantum mechanics works. So we haven't really found either a better theory or some phenomenon that we could actually hit on.
How are people supposed to resolve some of these foundational problems, such as quantum gravity, as you mentioned, or dark matter, without experiment to guide or to test between different theories? Because there are different proposed solutions to what dark matter is, as well as how to quantize gravity. It's just that they lie outside the experimental range. So would you say that's the theorist's fault, the experimentalist's fault, no one's fault?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So actually, you know, strictly speaking, one shouldn't lump all these problems together, because each problem is its own problem. And dark matter is quite different from the other problems that I mentioned, because in this case, we actually do have some experimental data. Like, so we know something isn't adding up, like quite literally, actually, if we just take the matter that we know of, that we have in the Standard Model, and we put it out there, it just doesn't properly work. And so introducing some sort of dark stuff is a fix that you can do, but for one thing, it doesn't always work the way that it should be, so it brings up some other problems. And also, it opens the question, like, what is it made of? Is it made of anything? And then there's this competing theory, modified Newtonian dynamics or modified gravity in more general, and we still haven't really you know, figure out how to rule one out or confirm the other, or and then these other questions which we have, like quantum gravity, is often portrayed as a problem of inconsistency, and we can talk about what exactly this means. Quantum mechanics, I've personally argued, it's also a problem of inconsistency, but if you ask other people in the field, they would object that this is the case. And then there are other problems that people like to talk about, which I actually think are not problems, which are some misgivings about the standard model, for example, like the strong CP problem, or it's supposedly unnatural, like why is the Higgs mass so small, the hierarchy problem, as it's sometimes called. And there are a list of other issues that people have, like the baryon asymmetry and stuff like that, where I would say these are not good problems because it's not clear that they actually require a solution. So you can say, I don't like it that the standard model just has these three generations and we have no deeper explanation for it, but maybe that's just how nature is. You know, maybe nature just has three generations and there's no deeper explanation. So I think it's not a good problem to work on because we've nothing really to start with. Like there's no problem that's actually in need of solving, if you see what I mean. It's not the case with quantum gravity, where you can say, okay, actually, if we just take general relativity and we combine it with the quantum field theory, it doesn't work. We don't know what to do. So there's a real need to actually develop new mathematics. And I think that's what makes this a promising avenue.
Just for people who are unaware of some of the problems or so-called problems, one is about CP violation. And then there's something called theta, which looks to be zero or close to zero. And then physicists don't like small values because they like to have some function that has a minimum of a small value. So they can say, okay, that's the reason for the small value. And you would say those are pseudo problems because maybe the reason is just how nature is. So let's talk about actual problems, which I believe you put into two categories. One of inconsistency with data. So perhaps the muon experiment would be that, or the data from it. And then the internal contradictions. So let's stick with internal contradictions. Quantum gravity is one, and the projection axiom of quantum mechanics is another. Is there another, or is it just those two for the internal contradictions?
Well, there are more technical issues related to quantum field theory, but it gets very mouthy very quickly. So maybe let's leave those aside. But yeah, there are some other mathematical issues that people have. Like, for example, I mean, you can ask, like, is quantum field theory actually a well-defined framework to begin with? Which is a very philosophical question to ask. You know, if it works, do we have to worry whether it's well-defined?
Oh, interesting. That's super interesting. I didn't know that. I thought you're going in the other direction of any progress towards well-defining QFT.
This is what I said. I don't want to talk about. because I don't really know. Really, this isn't something I have. Like axiomatic quantum field theory is not something that I've myself worked on. So I know it exists. I know there are problems that people work on, but I don't really know a lot about it. So it's,
I see.
You know, it's not a good topic to talk about because I'd just be talking random nonsense.
I see. So. Something I was going to say was, okay, would you consider soft theorems and asymptotic symmetries as progress in physics or progress in double copy relations like gauge gravity dualities or gauge gravity relations?
Well, this is all very interesting in the sense that it helps us to better understand the theories that we already have, but they don't really help us. You know, it's no new physics in the sense that it's not a fundamentally new phenomenon that has been predicted. It doesn't really, at least I don't see how it helps us answering these questions, like the big questions that we just talked about. So, of course, you know, people who work on in the field, they see a lot of progress because they write a lot of papers. They try very hard to understand the mathematics. And I'm not saying that this is all useless. You know, especially I recently talked about this in a video, the amplitude. amplitude-hedron
stuff.
So that's a very interesting development. And the entire area CFT stuff is also pretty cool. You know, they're learning lots about the mathematics of gauge theories, how quantum field theory actually works. Like, there are many more structures than we thought there are. But, you know, when it comes to those big fundamental questions that we started out talking about, at least right now, I don't really see what we learn from it about this. So there's a long story about Nimal Kani-Hammett and, you know, the demise of space-time, or it's doomed, right? This is like space-time is doomed, like this is the catchphrase.
Oh, yeah.
That might be like, so maybe this is actually the way to do it. So maybe we have to describe quantum physics in terms of these amplitude-hedra, and that will give us a clue for how to deal with quantum gravity. But at least at the moment, I don't see it happening.
Yes, and you also see that as an argument of serendipity, that hopefully if we explore this, we're going to stumble upon a solution, but there are multiple different avenues we could have gone down. And if we constantly justify our explorations, we'll stumble upon something that'll be useful.
So the issue is, serendipitous discoveries have happened and they'll probably continue to happen. But the question is, like, how likely is it? So I don't have a big problem with people like, actually, I don't have a problem with most people, period. But so, you know, research avenues like the amplitude-hedron or area CFT and other very math-heavy stuff might teach us something. And yes, you know, something surprising might come out of it. But I don't think it's, just historically, it's not been a super productive strategy. And historically, people have also had the advantage of having some data to go by. So you already raised this question, like, so this is like the big issue. Like, we don't have any data to guide us to a theory of quantum gravity. And so that just leaves a lot of space for playing around with the mathematics, and you can overdo this. You know, there's a lot of mathematics that you can guess, which is why we have all these different approaches to quantum gravity, right? And so everyone has their own idea about what's the right thing to do.
That's what this channel's about.
Yeah. So what do we do, Curt? Right? So do we just make videos about everything, and then at the end of the day we have a vote about which is the nicest one? I think that's not a good way to do it.
Well, for me, the amplitude-hedron didn't impress me. It was interesting, but it was specifically for a certain type of quantum field theory, N=4, super Yang-Mills planar as well. But then it's been generalized recently to shapeology, I believe. I believe it's shapeology. And so now it can calculate without supersymmetry for phi-3, phi-cubed, I believe. But anyway, the point is that you would classify that as cool, but not progress.
Well, in some sense it's progress, but it's not progress on the questions that we talked about, right? So at least I don't see how it's the case. So we can have an endless discussion about what exactly do we mean by progress, right? Is it progress to write a paper? I think personally, what I'm talking about is making progress on finding some sort of new physics. Like, and this, to my mind, is better understanding the theories that we already have. And yes, you can call this progress in some sense, but it's not personally what I'm interested in. And honestly, I think it's not what most people are interested in when they talk about the foundations of physics. And then you come back and say, yeah, but actually, you know, we have calculated some diagram to 3 more digits or something. They're like, oh yeah, I'm cool, nice.
New update, started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything, it's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, Thank you to our partner, The Economist.